Benjamin's storyteller and the public order Benjamin's thesis on philosophy of history, I noticed that very few people knew these essays, and they're such fun. And they're so generally referred to, you know, by people these days. I thought it was it'd be great. It's a pity that you didn't know them. And they also, I guess, inform my work a great deal, because, you know, the storyteller thing, and then the thesis on the philosophy of history, which has a very heart-rending history, how it was written, why it was written, I'll stop going into it. It's really a talk about the, amongst many ways of characterizing it, you could say one thing it deals with centrally is the upsurge of an image at a moment of danger. And in there there's a sort of messianic promise for a new society. Zoya had asked me about the re-enchantment, demystification and re-enchantment, and I think that thesis of the thesis of the philosophy of history, in a very abbreviated and almost bombastic manifesto way, make that provide a very clear example of that, and shows you the weird things that were going on in Benjamin's work between Marxism, anarchism, and the Kabbalah. And so the return of the Messiah is seen as real or metaphoric of what you know, people in Western Europe in the 30s, very different time to now, in some respects, for crucial respects, called revolution. So that those two essays, I thought I was we'll discuss them, okay, on Tuesday. So I had wanted to discuss the. I swear I saw this, the big fat thing you've got. So we'll have to push that back a day. And I wanted to show you a couple of movies on the last day. We'll just see how that goes. So at the moment, the last day is a little bit over. I just wanted to start with 5 minutes of a film by my friend, Matai Amara, the other side. For that good reason, I should keep it. But I just thought, I don't know, I just geared into it. I was watching it last night. I haven't seen it before. And I thought, oh, wow. I'm showing it. Principally, just a couple of minutes, because of what I said about storytellers, storytelling, Benjamin's notion of storytelling has taken a big dive with modernization. Is that true? Is that untrue? If so, in what ways? And what about the encounter between intellectuals, anthropologists, etc., in the metropole, whether the metropole is Paris, London, New York, or it's Bogota, Mexico City, etc., etc., and the people in the hinterland. And it's in that spirit that I'm showing it. Here we go. So, let's have a look at it. And then I'm going to just jump sideways and start talking about sunset essays. Okay? This is a film about the corrida, C-O-R-R-I-D-A, which is the story in song. And you might have picked up already in my color thing how important the song is to my way of thinking. I haven't talked about it in class yet. And of course, it has everything to do with the border, that ferociously hot border between Mexico and the US.
Por mi música, por el talento que tengo que cumplirme de aquí. ¿no? De los de México haciendo los correos, ¿no? La manera de explicar of translating to one person to another, you know?
Rap habla de historias de cosas que pasan en la calle y los correos igual hablan de cosas que sí pasan, es un modo de comunicación en las calles.
Difundiendo algo como una noticia.
Bueno, puede ser real o puede ser imaginario, más que más o menos tenga bonito acomodo.
Por primera vez, la voz de los traficantes, de manera indirecta, se está escuchando a través de los correos.
Es una denuncia, es una expresión del pueblo, muy directa.
En 15 minutos, tú vienes por decir, mira, yo quiero un correo. Me llamo el día de ayer, como gustan las muchachas, como está pintando el mando, me pasó por alguna parte. En 15 minutos me ganó 1.500 dólares. En 15 minutos, si es camarada, 1.000 dólares.
La pobreza que traigo en mi sangre, todo esto ya quiero que cambie. Somos pobres, no puedo negarle.
Yo no batallé nunca todo por la nube. Yo ahora me ojito así, lo claramente. Me sale el corazón, pues. Lo que importa es la letra, no la voz.
La pobreza que traigo en mi sangre, todo esto no, todo esto ya quiero que cambie. Somos pobres, no puedo negarle, pero puedo negarle.
So that's like a tag, but it's like something that we'll pick up when we're discussing Benjamin's essay on the storyteller. I wanted to start off today, to divide today up into two parts, one dealing with sunsets and one dealing with law and the lawless land. I posted some questions in an email because I discovered I had an email list for a lot of people here, and some of you might have thought it's there were five or six questions in there, and it was saying on the sunsets. And I said, oh, one of the questions that occurs to me, or first question that might occur to me when I'm reading the sunsets piece, is the relationship of past to present. And how is it that you can get something so innocent and ordinary, routine, like watching the sunset, how come that can link up to what you might call the history of the world? And if that's the case, what other sorts of ordinary, everyday, quasi-ritualistic activities do you and I perform that somehow have a potential, somehow have a message, if you like, that we didn't know, we didn't appreciate, until a crisis brings it to your attention? So here I am, I'm the advance guard of the crisis, giving you the little wake-up call. Take all that back, that's very narcissistic. But that's the sort of, I think that's the sort of strategy involved here, I hope. In Benjamin's thesis on the philosophy of history, now we're getting into that, this notion of an image flashing up at a moment of danger is very seductive, it's very enticing, it's very impossible to understand. Those things usually go together. And especially because he says the image surfaces at a moment of danger only to disappear. So I can get the surfacing bit, and I can think of examples, but why should it disappear as fast as it's coming up? You try and figure it out. What's going on in the sunset essay, sunsets take us back, is the title, takes us back, belongs to that family of concern, if you like, about something coming up in the moment of danger and doesn't disappear again. One of the things that it seems to me is that as the world lurches towards its self-destruction ecologically, and I'm not even talking economically and politically, is that the notion of nature as dead, which is sounds very simplistic, you know, too simplistic, but I think it's absolutely fair that what modernity did in Western Europe, or Western European, you know, US, etc., etc., was with what we call enlightenment, was to develop this subject-object distinction very fiercely. Of course, it had always existed, and in some extent always will, but it'll take different clothing, different forms at different times of history. And this subject-object distinction involving the notion that nature is dead, and to be is a thing. It is no longer animate. It's no longer like a spiritual or human-like or thinking quality to nature, say that the ancient Greeks had, or Australian Aborigines had, etc., etc. But no, nature is like a thing that can be manipulated, dominated, and so forth. It seems to me that with the crisis, which I'll call now global warming, it seems to me that this is producing, different degrees amongst different people, a sense that nature has come alive again, and that you no longer inhabit the same subject-object world that you did before. You know, slowly, slowly, slowly. And that's why I was so interested in the pre-Copernican, Copernican split in this sunsets take us back. Because one of the things, estrangement effects that occurs to me is try this experiment, try and be truly Copernican, and that is when you watch the sun setting, imagine the sun is staying in the same place, but you're the one who is moving, right? So you're on the planet and slowly moving, rotating that way. So you're watching the sun, and instead of seeing the sun go down, you're actually like going backwards, and you know, it's like this thing here. Here's the sun, and here's the planet Earth, and you've got to imagine that you're here, and that this thing is rotating, and you're like a lighthouse or a tree, and you're going backwards like this. And I just wrote it out the way I did as a sort of impossible experiment. It's very, very difficult to sort of think of yourself as doing that, right? It's so much easier to think that the sun is disappearing below the horizon. And in that dichotomy, I would like to think of the change, or the possibility of a change, or at least bring to awareness of what's involved, which is a person-centered view of the world, which is the, I can't draw it, person-centered view of the world versus a sense of being a node amongst being in the world. And I'll talk about that a bit later, but that's part of what that essay is talking about. Going back to this, what is the, when I think about the relationship between past and present, for example, this crazy Benjaminian thing, so seductive, image coming up at a moment of danger, I need to disappear, and then he has another part, another thesis, number four, number five, I forget, where you've got to grab on the image before it disappears, and before the ruling class, it's very like, you know, this is the last thing he wrote before he died, took his own life, 1940, poor food of Spain. Before the ruling class grabs a hold of the image and uses it to its own advantage. You know, it's sort of like very basic revolutionary doctrine 101, it sounds like, from a very super sophisticated European intellectual. When I think of past to present, I don't, only in the last, you know, couple of decades today, I feel at all comfortable with this notion of not continuity of past to present or continuity of time, but the notion of sort of staggered time, whereby something from the past ruptures something in the present. And of course this word rupture was very fashionable, and everybody is into fragments rather than continuity, fragments rather than narrative. You have to deal with the fact that it's all got sort of cliche by now. However, I'll stick with the cliches and move forward, move on. A convenient way of thinking of the group of the past and the present, or the presence of the past in the present, is to think of something that's existed forcefully a long time ago and now exists as mere residue. And Malinowski and the students at LSE used to talk about why men had buttons on their the cuffs of their suits, and what was the function of that. And that was, then they used to try and think, well, hundreds of years ago, it maybe had some function in male clothing, and it stuck on, and you still have it today as some sort of aesthetic adornment. But these sort of apparently silly questions would intrigue them. Why do these small little things exist in the present? And is it because they existed in the past, and they just gradually lost their function, but are still around? And they would bat that sort of issue backwards and forwards. The vision, the impulse that I had in writing this essay called Sunsets Take You Back is that this interest in sunsets that's expressed by this Indian-American artist, Kartik, who's done all these drawings and photographs from Native American mounds, the famous Mississippi mounds near Interstate 70, my sense is that they're premonitory. The mounds are very ancient, I mean about 1000 AD, sunsets seem as old as you can get, but the interest in it is future oriented. That's one of the main ideas I had in this essay. It's not a hangover from the past. Of course it's part of the treasure of the past, part of the baggage or material of the past, but it's something, it's like divinatory. That's the way I'm looking at it. And I wondered, in this regard, I thought maybe I'd say a couple of things. Do you know what these mounds are? I never knew what they were, so.
No.
And I'm meant to be an anthropologist. Well, apparently there's Mississippi Valley, which is basically all of America, from Canada down to the Gulf, to Louisiana, this huge river, like one of the world's biggest rivers, the Mississippi. It's called, so they called the Mississippi Valley, the guys who could get the big bird's eye view. And apparently, in different parts of that, certainly in Ohio and I guess in one of the Midwest states, there are these huge mounds. They're not as obvious as the pyramids in the Yucatan or around Mexico City. These gigantic earth structures, and no one knows what they're for or why, or you know, and they're being turned into, you know, obviously tourist attractions. And what Kartik was interested in was photographing people watching the sunset from these mounds, and so I took off from there. So you've got this whole Native American issue. Not that far away.
Missouri.
Yeah, because he's working out of St. Louis.
Yeah, Mississippi goes through St. Louis.
So you've been on the mountain?
No, but I remember learning about them a bit. And the Mississippian period was really well developed. It was like a very complex, well developed society right before kind of European came.
So here's highways, Interstate 70. Here the mounds, full of Native American aura. Otherwise, it just looks like an old hill. you haven't got that Teotihuacan thing going. And here's the sun setting. Here people. And here's Kartik, for his movie camera. There's an article by a guy who loves catastrophe called Mike Davis. Anybody know his work? He's a very, very polished writer. He lives in LA and Hawaii, and his most famous book is City of Quartz. Almost know it. Who else is familiar? I see. Okay. This is the book on LA, and it's he's got this absolutely like sick fascination with fires and mudslides and the horrors of the world, particularly the horrors of California, deeply concerned with labor unions, Mexican immigrants, and so forth. And Mike Davis has got many books, and one of them is called Dead Cities. And the first couple of essays are incredibly like stirring and interesting, but he's so fanatical with this like apocalyptic viewpoint that after a while, I think he just gets sick of it. But he has an essay in there which is really wonderful on the ghost dance. You know about the ghost dance at all? Ghost, G-H-O-S-T. I think we need to have a course for about a year.
Yeah.
So I can vomit all this stuff out. Ghost dance. Have you known the book Black Elk Speaks?
Yeah. It was from Black Elk. He's developed.
So one person knows the Black Elk book?
I know Black Elk book.
Huh?
I know the Black
two.
Elk.
Two.
Two, three, yeah, okay. So Black Elk Speaks, I can't tell too much about this stuff, get sidetracked, but the ghost dance was so-called, what academics call a millenarial movement. The name is not all that appropriate, but the type of movement which foresees the end of the world and the ushering in of a new and better world. And like wildfire, the ghost dance spread amongst Native Americans in about 1880 and lasted about 15 years and still exists in different forms today. But the ghost dance starts off with a prophet called Wovoka, who's English name was like John Smith or something. He was a shepherd working for a rancher in the Rockies, and he had these visions, which are very common, right, amongst certain type of Native American groups. Had this vision that the white man, there'd be this cataclysm. The white man and all his belongings would disappear, and the buffalo would return, and once again. Indians would have their lands back and live as they did before, sort of thing. And what they had to do was either this would cause speed it up, or you just got into this dance to reassure yourself or enjoy that, or and so forth. And so people would have special clothing which they saw in visions and then would paint on their shirts, and they would dance around some sort of emblem of the sun, depends which part of the US we're talking about, and go into trance and lie down and see this new world that is about to come. And Black Elk Speaks is one very, very extraordinary document where an old Indian is relating this, who can't speak English, is relating this to a white man, there's a lot to tell you about how that was done. But the ghost dance prophet, or Volker, is visited by Mark Davis somewhere near Las Vegas. And Mark Davis writes this incredibly powerful piece about that. And he relies on a guy called Mooney, who was an ethnographer, one of those government ethnographers, James Mooney, who wrote a book about death thick on the ghost dance for the US government, or the Bureau of American Ethnology, around 1880, because the US Army was particularly freaked out by the ghost dance. And one of the things that always interests me is why colonial governments do get freaked out by blind superstition movements. You know, because if you've got this rational, irrational thing going, you might, well, I guess I can see why they'd be concerned, but it still always intrigues me. There was a power line going up near where I live upstate, and a student of mine, Todd Ramon Ochoa, he works a lot in Havana, and he's very into a magical curing and killing religion called Palo, and he's very into these signs, which in Haiti are called Vive, that they use in Vodun dances in Haiti. You know, I can't really draw them very well, but sort of crosses and curved lines and a little bit of figuration. So we were also pissed off with this power line that Todd went up there one night and drew these vive on the pylon. And I was up in the caravan where the workers were, it was winter, and they were all, you know, foremen, not the workers, not the ordinary workers, and they're all sitting around, you know, with a big cup of coffee at 8 o'clock in the morning, and then I overhear them saying they call the sheriff because of these signs. And they were not freaked out, but they were freaked out. How come these big grown men who've got this whole rational thing going with the power lines, they're be so sort of nervous about these insignia? Anyway, so Mooney was Irish, and he was part of had this Irish, you know, the way some of these Irish people are, they can't stand the British. And that's why Davis is also into that. He's a displaced Englishman, Davis, working class sort of guy. He really grooves on Mooney, and Mooney writes this huge book, sort of boring really, maybe 800 pages, everything you ever want to know, you know, about the ghost dance. He writes this essay Davis writes this essay as a sort of a testimony to the ghost dance and to Volker, the original visionary. And by the way, the ghost dance came basically to a dramatic finish when the US Army committed this incredible slaughter. It's called the Battle of Wounded Knee, and it's incredibly famous, and that's what Black Elk talks about. He was one of the Indians involved in the resistance to the US Army when they just shot all these men, women, and children in the snow, starving, and they were lined up, and a young US soldier said he thought he saw an Indian going for a gun, and then they just went berserk and killed them all, and then all the Indians from surrounding places got up on their ponies and with their ghost ships on, they sort of thought they were immune. That says it very clearly. They're totally immune from US bullets with these shirts and so on. So it's a very dramatic moment, I think, in modern history. And so Davis uses this, and he says the ghost dance is still, this is my point, finally, ghost dance is sort of brewing in America again. And then he moves the focus of attention to the to LA and the seedier, desperate parts of LA, and looks for signs of this sort of resurgence. And that's probably a very over-dramatic example of what I'm trying to talk about with the sunset thing, okay? Now, I wanted to ask you if any of you have come across the phrase invention of tradition. Could you tell us about it?
I just wanted to refer to a passing by my friend Lawrence Kiermaier, who's...
I've lost my voice.
But my friend Lawrence Kiermaier, who's a transcultural psychiatrist, refers to when people really have quite new ideas, contemporary ideas, but they want to insert them in a tradition, to create a tradition. It happens in many spheres of life. I don't know if I can talk about it more than that.
Yeah. Well, invention of tradition was a term coined in the late 80s, I guess, by Eric Hobsbawm. You know the name?
Yeah.
He's like England's preeminent historian. he does such a wonderful guy. He's about 92 now. He was a member of the British Communist Party for ages and ages. After everyone else left, because they said the Communist Party is a piece of shit, he still hung on. Jewish guy born in Egypt. Hobsbawm.
B-A-W-M.
And he wrote some big works on British capitalism and British imperialism, the books that some people have read, he's more anarchic books, which is called Primitive Rebels and Bandits. But Hobsbawm and a guy called Ranger put it together a set of essays called Invention of Tradition. And to me it was shocking because it said, hey, you know what? A lot of things that we think of as traditional were invented yesterday. And I know it sounds so simple when I put it like that, but it's actually devastating house cleaning of your mind. And you start to get like, I think the tenant was saying, you start to get like a little bit paranoid about all these things I thought were so old, like these old stone roofs, these old houses, you know, and the Scottish kilt, and whatever it might be, it's got venerability about it. In fact, you often find that they're almost, you know, invented yesterday, and you suddenly accepted them as not like that at all. So I just wanted to send out a little warning signal. And in that book called Invention of Tradition, you come across 8 or 9 marvelous examples of how stuff can be invented yesterday, but everybody takes it as deep history. So it serves a cynical function, but at the same time you've got to ask yourself, why do some things that are invented stick and others don't? Why can Chavez in Venezuela go on and on about Simón Bolívar and it seems to stick? And why would we think about it in the first place? And you know now you're entering a very complex territory of myth and reality, let's put it that way. And so these things that are invented, they're not invented out of nothing, is what I'm saying. So now I'm complicating the notion of invention of tradition. You know, first you can be smarty pants in Senegal and say, you know, I can prove to you that the Scottish kilt was actually, it's not thousands of years old, it was in, the, you know, 1885 when there was some issue with the British Crown or the Irish or something like that, and these dudes started to wear, you know, dresses instead of pants and stuff like that. And you thought it was, you know, ancient Scottish tradition, but it's not, you know, this sort of statement. Then your next question might be, yeah, but why? Why did it spread? Why? What made it click? So I wanted to throw that in terms of thinking about past and present. On the Benjamin thesis that is basically number 5, the true picture of the past flits by. The past can be seized only as an image which flashes up at the instant when it can be recognized and is never seen again. That's it. 6, to articulate the past historically does not mean to recognize it the way it really was. That's a quote, the way it really was. That's sort of like historians might like to think that they're just telling the story of the past. And Benjamin says, to articulate the past historically does not mean to recognize it the way it really was. It means to seize hold of a memory as it flashes up at a moment of danger. Historical materialism wishes to retain the image of the past, which unexpectedly wishes to appears to a person singled out by history at a moment of danger. So, to go from the sublime to the ridiculous, from the profound to the superficial, shallow, that drawing of mine in I Swear I Saw this image, the whole book is really about one image, one really badly drawn image. One of the zillion ways I approached this image, and I've got to stress the zillion ways, was to mention this thesis. And I do it very modestly, and I say, I know this sounds really like over the top, but you know, there's something in that, because that's an image of a moment of danger for me and the people involved. Historical materialism wishes to retain an image of the past which unexpectedly appears to a person singled out by history at a moment of danger. The danger affects both the content of tradition and its receivers. The same threat hangs over both, that of becoming a tool of the ruling classes. In every era, the attempt must be made anew to wrest, grab tradition away from conformism, a conformism that is about to overpower it. The Messiah comes not only as the Redeemer, he comes as the subduer of the Antichrist. Only that historian will have the gift of fanning the spark of hope. That goes back to Zoya's question. Well, you know, she just wanted examples, so I'm not giving an example, but I'm just reiterating, echoing the desire, the need. Only that historian will have the gift of fanning the spark of hope in the past, who is firmly convinced that even the dead will not be safe from the enemy if he wins. And the enemy has not ceased to be victorious. Now, you know, Marie Foy on the run. You've got a picture of against the wall type writing here. I wanted to bring in some of the. So that's the invention of tradition stuff, and it's a very fascinating historian. This is the drawings that I've also screwed up now. Because you guys can read these things. You're doing other stuff, I know. You're just specialists, we've all got our tracks. I wanted to talk a little bit about how the sunset thing to me fits into what I call the bubbly unconscious. And what I mean by that is, I think what comes across in that sunset take you back is a sense of the knowledge that I'm talking about is what I'll call bodily knowledge as opposed to knowledge. And of course it sounds very mysterious and wonderful. I don't know if I can make it any less mysterious and ruin its wonder in so doing. It seems to me that there's a relationship between the human body and other human bodies, and I think you probably can sense that in its different forms and manifestations. And there's a tie between the human body and all the other bodies. That's the sun, the moon, the stars, the ocean, this bowl of tape, whatever. But we don't normally think that way. But my feeling is that as we now enter into this crisis of the world imploding, just being destroyed, so we're going to move from a view of nature as dead, in a sense, back to, but we're of course going to go forward to, back to these in Western European history, medieval and earlier conceptions of nature as animate, and that we are no longer this lighthouse with these antennae and these portals for seeing and so forth, and a more sort of suffused knowledge, organic thing, which the body is part of the body of the world. So the bodily unconscious to me is knowledge that you're not actually conscious of. And as I went to medical school, I have sort of a rap on this. And I know you don't want to go too far down this road because these scientific fables are very dangerous. There's a thing called the sometimes called the autonomic nervous system, and you know how much I love the nervous system. And the way the body adapts to changes in temperature, changes in altitude, night and day, stress, etc., etc., is automatic. Like if I go into a dark room, my what do you call these things, pupils, they get wide without me having to say, pupil! It all happens in a flash. It happens in a zillionth of a second, right? And tons of stuff is happening in your body all the time without, thank God, you having to be regulated. Because if you did, I'm sure you would screw up. You know, you'd forget to say pupil, and then you'd fall over the cliff or something. I mean, so this is a huge part of being alive that, most of the time works really well. And it sort of means automatic nervous system. And what's the next step that I want to get across here? I was talking with a tall guy on the way up the hill here, and he told me he was a ski instructor in Austria. And I said, oh, wow, I'd love to be able to ski and all this sort of stuff. And I said, how do you get that confidence to just go with the flow, you know, on the skis and not be frightened? And how do you handle that? And we started to talk a little bit about this word flow, the body interaction with the snow and the slopes and so forth. And I said, you know, I have this theory called the body unconscious, in which you become a great skier or a skier by not thinking too much. And the trouble is, if you think a lot about it, you're likely to do some damage to the relationship between the unconscious and the conscious parts of you. And so this is not the Freudian unconscious, so I have no problem with it being, you know, connected, but it's not the Freudian unconscious. Nietzsche says, in the color thing that I handed out, he says, isn't all philosophy an understanding, dash, or rather a misunderstanding, dash, of the body? And that's sort of the route path that I would like to follow. Maybe all philosophy is a misunderstanding of the body. When you get the Nietzschean sieve, you know, you're pushing everything through the sieve and you're sieving it all, whatever the problem it is, it will slowly percolate out down the bottom that it really was some philosophers actually on about the body. You know. So, not language, body. You know. I said to this guy, you know, the ski instructor guy, and we were thinking about that, I said, you know, I grew up, however, not with snow, but with water in Sydney, and I used to swim a lot in the ocean and stuff like that. And then one day I went back to Australia, and I'm out in the ocean, way up, past the surf break, and it suddenly occurred to me, I must have been about 35, 40, that floating in the water was really strange. And how come I wasn't going to sink? And I had this sort of panic, and it seemed to be totally abnormal to be in the water. And I had to really work hard on myself to say, everything you're thinking is crazy. You know, 35, 40 years of floating in the water, why should it stop? And why should you think that that's abnormal? But I want to get this little incident over to you as a sort of a break or an interruption or a threat of where the conscious-unconscious balance goes out of sync for a while, and so on. Now, my feeling is, I know this is a little bit hysterical, with global warming, with these tremendous weather changes in weather patterns, and overall augmentation of body temperatures, which will be much more severe, you know, in tropical climates than elsewhere, that human body will, the question is, how much will the human body change? Now, people will fight it, you know, like all of India is now going to have air conditioning, and the West is freaked out because, you know, it's going to be further pollution, and in Japan, there's going to be like cool down the entire cities by pouring the seawater through and under the city and out. Singapore, with all its fascist control and money, has no doubt got, you know, the whole city is going to be cooled down by artificial means, and there'll be these huge attempts by rich countries to try and, you know, make personal life more comfortable, and burgeoning in rich countries like China and India. But basically what I'm getting, it's more like a fairy story than a real story. It helps me figure out my thoughts on this. To the extent that the human body is going to have to cope with severe changes in its environment the next X years, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 100, my feeling was that this arrangement of consciousness to unconsciousness, this character of the bodily unconscious, is going to be affected, such that I was wondering whether the mind-body relationship could change, and with it, the subject-object relationship could change. And I think the most interesting aspect of all of this is my sense of a different awareness of bodies to bodies. And that's, of course, where some of my interest in sympathetic magic comes in, because it's this, instead of having links of cause and effect, like the billiard ball, the black billiard ball, it's the white billiard ball, it's the red billiard ball, bump, 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 bump. Instead of that view of being, of causation, this other view of bodies and bodies is much more like the old medieval and maybe Greek view, sure, India, Middle Eastern, and so forth, of microcosm and macrocosm, of pattern thinking, of the mimetic faculty. And I got that first paragraph of On the Mimetic Faculty by Benjamin, and it's interesting to listen to. You could write a very long essay on what you think about this. In other words, I'm saying, don't take it uncritically, but it is fascinating. This is the first paragraph. It's like 2.5 pages of nature creates similarities. One need only think of mimicry. The highest capacity for producing similarities, however, is man's. Sorry about the sexism. His gift of seeing resemblances is nothing other than a rudiment of the powerful compulsion in former times to become and behave like someone, something else. Perhaps there is none of his higher functions in which his mimetic faculty does not play a decisive role. Well, as each sentence could be discussed there, when he refers to higher functions, of course, he's going to take on language, this non-Saussurean, this non-arbitrariness of the sign theory. But what I would like to draw your attention to is this assertion of Benjamin's, with powerful compulsion in former times to become and behave like something else. And he talks about children's games in his world, and goes on. And I want you to sort of be sympathetic to that. I want you to be kind to that idea and think about, do you ever have that feeling yourself? And if not, why not? When Nietzsche in Twilight of the Idols, in his last book, before the one his sister put together, his Nazi sister, talks about Dionysus. Now, I always freak out when I hear the word Dionysus. I always think of the macho guys running around and talking about, you know, being wild and sexual freedom and all this and all that. And now I've kind of sort of simmered down a bit. I don't go crazy when I hear the term. I accept it. And Nietzsche changes his view of Dionysus. But in the last book, Twilight of the Idols, kind of your book where he summarizes his thought, he talks about Dionysus, you know, who's always Dionysus is half male, half female. Dionysus is the stranger who comes from God knows where. Dionysus is like the Pied Piper that comes to town and all the kids go crazy, all the women go crazy, whatever it might be. And they're in nature and in the woods and they're against the state. And his Bacchae is all about that. It's a bloody ending. But Nietzsche talks about Dionysus as the Dionysic character, the Dionysic person, as the one who is in love with mimicry, in love with imitating, to such a degree that this Dionysic character, male or female, is sort of sick, and he calls it an hysterical person, that they cannot stop becoming something else. Now, you know, it's an intelligent, rational guy. And so when I say to you, don't reject the notion of being and transforming out of hand, I want you to try and make that thought experiment, particularly when you're listening to my notions of the bodily unconscious that come up with the sun and the sunset. And in this book, the color book, there's a chapter called Where Stones Walk Like Men. I'll quote a little bit from it. As our bodies as well as our outlook changes in a dangerous world, now subject to rising seas, hurricanes, and pestilence, illnesses, heat detaches the senses from the complacent view of the human body as a fortress with peepholes and antennae, mine aren't so good, sensing externalities, and instead encourage us to take a world-centered and not a self-centered approach to viewing, such that the self becomes part of that which is seen and not a sovereign, transcendent. To thus consciously see ourselves in the midst of the world is to enter into ourselves as image, to exchange standing above the fray, the God position, for some quite other position that is not really a position at all, but more like swimming, more like nomads adrift in the sea, mother of all metaphor, that sea I call the bodily unconscious. It's a great chapter, but I'm not going to read it because I think you're getting out there. This is sort of deadly. The final thing I want to say about this sun essay, I mean, there's a lot to say, the sunset essay, was the importance of the sun in for certain thinkers. So I suppose one of the things I've got going here is really a renewed look at sympathetic magic and mimesis. Sympathetic magic, mimesis, and micro-macro thought. And all this is tied into a sense that, you know, when we were younger, people would always say, oh, you must historicize. You know, this seems a good critique. You didn't have a historical sense to your work. And I think that can get boring after a while, but I think for our conversation here, it's absolutely, it's very important, because all of this is tied to a sense of the world is changing very fast, and trying to understand where we've come from and where we're going to and what we can do about it, right? As regards the sun, I was thinking a lot about Nietzsche and the way his work is so full of sun imagery, as it is with the sea. So that Lucy Rigaret could write a book called Marine Lover, and it's her exploration of some of that. The famous Thus Spake Zarathustra begins with Zarathustra alone, a hermit, you know, lonely old lonely guy, usual, you know, misanthropic male figure who's got all this knowledge and all this thinking and wants to come down to earth and spread the word and talks to the sun and says something like, you are overflowing star that rises in the morning and sinks in the evening in the sea. I must go down with you, and like you, I must give and give and give. This sort of sense. And Zarathustra, from the very, and it's the god of, you know, religion of fire, Zoroastrianism and so forth, has this fantastic, how should I put it, modern mythology of the sun. And the Thai, who, you know, reads Nietzsche very carefully and follows on, has in the Visions of Isis, a book I think we'd all get a lot out of, has several essays, at least on the sun. Has anybody read those essays, the surrealist essays, Hansa, Carolina? And do you remember the essays in there on the sun at all, the titles or anything?
Solar
Anus? Yep, Solar Anus is one. And there's a Suve.
Oh, yeah, I love that, the volcano.
Huh?
The volcano. Related to volcano.
Can't remember that. I'll put down volcano.
Yeah.
And in his later work, his post-surrealist work, called The Accursed Share, La Part Maudite, 37 French, mm-hmm. pronunciation. His first section of that book is the superabundance, the dépense, the excess that nature gives rise to. And he says, he talks about plants and all this crazy wildlife going on around us. What's the purpose? And this exuberance, that's the way he wants to look at the natural world. We've all been taught through Darwin and our physics teacher that everything that goes on in nature has this sort of beautiful cause and effect, functionalist, very efficient relationship. And you will marvel at that as a child or as an adult, and you'll pick up on that. But time wants to do something completely else. He wants to say, look, a lot of this stuff is completely dysfunctional, and it's just like this nature bursting out and so forth. And the one metaphor that he has that really is interesting is that the sun gives without receiving. The sun gives without receiving. And it's stuck in my mind a great deal. How you play and work with that is another thought. So they are the remarks I wanted to make about that essay, and I wanted to throw it open for discussion, and after coffee let's talk about the law and the lawless land. But I've thrown a lot of stuff out. You've probably got comments, questions, irritations, stimulations.
I was just thinking while you were talking, you know, with the Mississippian, I don't remember the details, but I took the class, it was like But the sun was a very central figure. So the idea of the sunset and then also these mountains and the sun was just so incredibly important in those cultures. And I think for that one, but a lot of those in that time, they had basically a sun king, and it was like an oligarchy. And through this whole, you know, through the myth of the sun, you know, that it would get passed down. So
but the sun was gone.
Yeah.
So, I mean, why do people... have you guys ever looked at the sunset?
Yeah.
Okay, so... let's start off basic. So, what's going on?
In October, you mean? Or in the ritual of the...
Yeah, more like... Yeah, ritual or semi-ritualized... Why does it capture our imaginations? Why do we decide at a certain point to come over to my place and we'll have a drink and watch the sun go down?
The color.
The colors?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a closing of the day, and it's the closing of your day. It's
mm-hmm.
the ending of the light, and it takes you through the dark where you may not have the sunrise again. So there is a faith. And